Hi, people who are coming in. We are just waiting as folks gather in. So welcome. I see Kat is in the house.
Hi, Kat.
Hi, Kat.
Hello.
Okay. Oh, yeah, we're getting some chats, some hellos and some hellos and some love. Kat says sending much love. You all look great, in case you all are not watching the chat. All right, welcome. Shall we get underway? Okay. Hi everyone. Oh yes, folks who are joining, feel free to say hello and tell us where you're coming from in the chats. We love seeing that. We love it. I am Jen Shook, and welcome to a Borderless event. Acting together on the world stage, theater without borders, and social justice and the performing arts. Oh, I love seeing where people are coming in from all over the world. So I'm Jen Shook. I'm a professor, a visiting assistant professor of theater history and American studies at the University of Iowa. And I am curator of this Borderless series, which is a collaboration between University of Iowa Theater Arts and UI's Multicultural and International Student Support and Engagement Centers. So I'm putting our series link in the chat. If you open up the chat, you're going to see a lot of info from the panelists, and myself and University of Iowa dramaturg Rob Ascher are curating the chat as we go. So feel free to make comments, say hello, tell us where you're coming from in the chat. Feel free to ask questions in the chat. We'll be watching it. You can also ask a question by hitting the Q&A function, and you should be able to upvote other questions that other people have asked that you're really interested in hearing in that Q&A function as well. And we'll give everyone a chance to speak for a bit before we come to those questions, but absolutely feel free to drop them in at any point. We are coming to you. I am coming to you from Iowa City and the University of Iowa, which is located on the homelands of the Ojibwe Anishinaabe, the Bahoche, the Kickapoo, the Menominee, Miyamiki, Nutachi, Umaho, Wasaje, Juwere, Odawa, Ponca, Potawatomi, Anishinaabe, Meskwaki, Nemahaki, Sakawaki, Dakota, Lakota, Nakota, Sahish, Nubaha, Nueta, and Ho-Chunk nations, and the Umaha or Omaha, the Ponca, and the Meskwaki or Sac and Fox, and Ho-Chunk or Winnebago tribe of Nebraska nations are all still here in this state. So we continue to acknowledge and honor and work with them through the university. We also, of course, are gathering today via seemingly intangible technologies with real infrastructural and ecological impacts, because we're here via Zoom, which is headquartered in what is now called San Jose. And that are the traditional lands of the Ohlone, Temyan, and Muwekma peoples. And Zoom operates via pieces large and small, from enormous buildings of servers to copper wiring originally designed by Navajo women weavers. So we acknowledge that as well. I also want to give a short pitch before I turn it over for an upcoming event. Next Friday, we will be gathering for How to Devise Theater That Makes a Difference, also on Zoom, also at 11 a.m. Central. And you will find the registration link in that Borderless link that I dropped in the chat, which I will put there again. We'll be having a conversation on interview-based community-engaged theater curated by University of Iowa MFA acting student Katie Guchik. And we will be joined by the guests Amanda Grace Ewing, director of the University of Michigan Educational Theater Company, an applied social justice theater company, and Jeffrey Pufall, who's a publicly engaged theater scholar in the Center for Arts and Medicine at the University of Florida. That promises to be interesting. We've also had great recent conversations on Cuban theater and culture, and on queer archives and how we learn and teach each other queer history. And recordings of those events will be turning up on our website shortly. So stay tuned for that. So all that said, I am going to turn it over to the magnificent David Diamond to handle the rest of our events, our master of ceremonies.
Thanks, Jen. It's great to be here. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone, wherever you happen to be in the world. I'm David Diamond, core member of Theater Without Borders, professor of theater at Columbia University, and the director of the LaMama Umbria International Residencies, Jen's like, I've been there, symposia and retreats. Thank you all for being here today. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the plight of the Ukrainian people and victims of other conflicts around the world. Please join me in a moment of silence as we remember our friends and colleagues. Thank you. Thank you. Many of us have been in touch with our artist friends and colleagues in Ukraine, and the stories are truly horrific. But these atrocities around the world, past and present, are part of the reason that it's so important that we're here today to celebrate the milestone 10th anniversary of the Acting Together project. The project shares the work and lifts the profile of artists as they continue to play a vital role in the transformation of conflict, in understanding our common humanity, and in healing our communities. The collaboration led to the publication of two volumes of case studies, a documentary film, various convenings, conversations, and actions. Congratulations to everyone who's participated in this groundbreaking project. As we move forward, we also celebrate a new collaboration between Theater Without Borders and the University of Iowa, which you will hear more about. Welcome to our conversation with the creators of the Acting Together project based at Brandeis University, Theater Without Borders, and the University of Iowa Department of the Arts. We'll begin by thanking the University of Iowa's Jen Shook from the Borderless series, Lisa Schlesinger, co-founder and director, and Roberta Levitow as co-founder with Katherine Fiu of Theater Without Borders, who helped organize this event. And additionally, Theater Without Borders co-founders and leaders, Eric N., Deborah Bravort, and Daniel Banks. The Acting Together project documents and strengthens the contributions of performance and ritual to social justice and conflict transformation. Acting Together was developed through a unique and historic collaboration between scholars affiliated with Brandeis University and the Theater Without Borders network of global practitioners. As it says in volume one of the Acting Together anthology, I promise I won't read the whole anthology, this work is dedicated to the unsung artists and community leaders whose creative and courageous acts contribute to the transformation of conflicts in regions all around the world. Personally, I first connected to the project through the Theater and Peacebuilding Conference, which was held at LaMama Experimental Theater Club in New York. We had the good fortune to welcome many of the artists who have contributed to the project to see their work and hear their inspiring stories. That convening changed the direction of my own artistic interrogation and led to great collaborations with many artists I met there, including some who are with us today. As we consider the history of the project, the outcomes as a result of this important work, and potential for the future, today, we look forward to our conversation with all of you and hope you will post your comments and questions in the chat. The event will be about 60 minutes with a bit more time available for those of you who wish to stay in this room and continue the discussion. We will be recording, or we are recording this event, and it will be available on the Acting Together website starting April 12th. The link will be in the chat. So I'm pleased to introduce members of the Acting Together team. Then we will show a trailer of the documentary, and followed by that, we'll have our conversation, and you can find full bios of all the speakers and their organizations' websites, which are being posted in the chat. So please join me in welcoming Cynthia Cohen, the director of the Peacebuilding and Arts Program at Brandeis University, and the director of the project Acting Together on the World Stage. Polly O. Walker, one of the co-editors of the Acting Together anthologies, contributor to the documentary, and co-author of The Toolkit. The anthologies are available at Prairie Lights Bookstore and at the website posted in the chat. And we welcome Allison Lund, the director of the Acting Together documentary. So for those of you who haven't been familiar with it in the past, we're going to show you the trailer to the Acting Together documentary first, and then we'll have our discussion. Rob? Rob is going to share the screen. Hey, Rob. There we go.
Oh, that's the full documentary. And we want the trailer on the documentary page, not the Borderless page.
Growing up in Argentina, my life was very much marked by the number of military dictatorships that I had to endure.
In Australia, it was official government policy to remove Aboriginal children from their parents for a whole range of reasons.
We were compelled by Idi Amin to go watch a firing squad so people could be afraid.
What is it that makes theatre extraordinary? What is it that makes it extraordinary enough for people to stop and think and change?
I was a co-founder of the Free Southern Theater in 1963. Our vision was that we would encourage political organizers to look to the arts to support oppressed people. What we can do as artists, we can let our imagination soar and say, I can envision the time when we will be able to plant the rice and eat it too. You know, I can see that.
In our city and in the city center, we had many paramilitary pro-war nationalists wearing guns and weapons. We could have expected anything to happen, but the miracle was that nothing violent happened. Suddenly, our discipline was stronger than our circumstances. We would see very aggressive people in the audience, and then their friends would be making them silent, like, hush, like, oh, I want to hear.
The whole theater process also resulted in a very intense, deep or high level conversation. talking about their lives and interacting and showing themselves in at a level of vulnerability that you never see these men, who in the media are always amorphous, superficial, stigmatized or stereotyped figures. And I think that's the power of this kind of theater.
Ik was advocaat, maar in Nederlands ben ik niks.
Every single time, in silence, the audience would stand up. And just that very simple gesture, it was an amazing act of resistance. And it was saying, no matter what is going on, this is not affecting the deepest fabric of community. And we're going to overcome.
I cannot hope for a democratic society without giving tools. What we're trying to offer through the foreign theater is an interactive learning. What is my role if this is not what I want in my community? What can I do?
If a play sets out to say this is what it means to be living in war, such a play for me is examining the human condition. I think peacebuilding or peacemaking is about the human condition, and there you find a connection.
Is the use or the utilization of theater for a very, very clear social or political purpose even legitimate? That's a dilemma.
I thought I need to learn more about how to assess where I am, how to understand what my work is, and how to behave appropriately, not just as an artist, but as a citizen.
There are not too many places where we can come together to learn how to do this work.
Theater requires engagement with the fundamental questions of our lives. These questions are crucial, essential. We're endangered by not answering them. All of these theater artists refuse to be in denial.
Thank you very much. It's wonderful to see you again. I encourage everybody, if you haven't seen it, please watch the entire documentary. It is inspiring and educational, and it's important. So please, everybody, take a look at it. Seen it many times, and I think you should do it as well. Okay, Cindy, Polly, I wanted to ask you about both your experience doing this project, as I congratulate you for doing it, but what are the important lessons that you've taken away? It's been 10 years. How are you seeing it now?
Oh, I might begin. Is that fine with you, Cindy?
Yes, please.
I'd like to start by saying it's been an honor to be a part of the network that contributed to Acting Together. And two of the most important lessons that I have taken from our collaborations are the power of performance to affect measures of justice and to transform conflict, as well as the range of art forms and cultural work that have made significant contributions to building peace. Forgive my allergies. I would like to share three types of performances that the anthologies integrate and then give examples that illuminate their power. The first type is ritual and ceremony. Performance that enhances solidarity among humans and that renews and strengthens relationships of body, mind, and spirit, as well as enhancing relationships between humans, the natural world, spirit ancestors, and generations to come. In volume one of the anthology, we see the transformative power of ritual and ceremony in the Mile Creek Massacre Memorial, an annual event that takes place each June in New South Wales, Australia, commemorating the massacre of a group of Wiradjuri Aboriginal people, mostly older men, women, and children. The Mile Creek Memorial has developed collaborations of integrity between Aboriginal and settler Australians These collaborations honor and recenter Indigenous epistemologies and ontologies, which have been suppressed by coloniality. Some of these collaborations are deeply moving and personal, such as the relationship between Sue Blacklock, Aboriginal descendant of survivors of the massacre, and Beulah Adams, descendant of one of the perpetrators. In a moving ritual, Sue invited Beulah to be her sister, a relationship not extended lightly, particularly. The memorials have also enhanced agency for social and restorative justice. The land near the massacre site has been named a heritage site, and under the laws of Australia can never be privatized. A cultural center is being created with the performance grounds and the native plant gardens already complete. A comprehensive history of the massacres of Aboriginal people will feature in exhibits when the center is completed. These memorials also engage with epistemic justice. The rituals, dances, music, and art of Aboriginal peoples form the heart of the memorials, a stark contrast to the marginalization of Aboriginal knowledge and reality that characterized so many Indigenous settler relationships. Another type of performance featured in the anthologies is community-based performance. Cultural productions in which community members, usually with little or no training in performance, act under the guidance of professional artists skilled in performances and in community work. Community members bring their identities and their embodied knowledge of local histories, cultures, and sensibilities, which inform the content of the performances. In such work, aesthetic elements such as refugee camp slang, gendered body language, and self-deprecating humor can communicate powerfully with an audience. In the second volume of the anthology, and you saw a clip of this in that trailer, theater director Eugene Van Irvin shares a compelling example of community theater, a play entitled In the Name of the Fathers, put on by Father Center Adam. Van Irvin describes the reach and the impact of this community-based performance. A few thousand people came to see the play. National and local media picked it up. The performances demonstrably succeeded in breaking down stereotypical notions of Muslim, Caribbean, and working class men and caused a shift in public thinking about how men needed to be included in emancipation processes. The third type of performance we explored in the anthologies is artist-based performance. Productions in which professionally trained artists use a full range of formal elements to invite people into experiences of beauty, reaching beneath people's defenses and opening them to feelings, insights, and questions designed to pursue justice and build peace. In the cases curated in the anthologies, the performance artists are attuned to and engaged with the needs and issues of their communities and societies. An example of excellence in artist-based peace-building performance, drawing on the chapter by Roberto Varela, is that of El Grupo Cultural de Yuyachcani in Peru. After the military dictatorship in Peru ended in 2001, and the Truth and Reconciliation Commission was established with Solomon Lerner Febres as its head, he invited Yuyachcani to accompany the TRC into the areas that had suffered the worst of the atrocities, supporting the commission's work and collecting testimonies. Varela describes the power of this collaboration. The TRC recognized that this rich and evocative power of theater could further post-war transition, dignify the victims, honor the dead and disappeared, and prompt people to come forward and speak publicly without fear. And the time we have doesn't allow me to do these examples justice. So I encourage all of you who are listening today and to share with your friends and colleagues to read fuller accounts of these performances in the anthologies and to watch the full documentary.
Thank you. Cindy?
Yeah. Thanks, Polly. Well, speaking personally, I feel that an important learning that emerged from acting together came from the experience of co-editing the anthology with Roberto and Polly. Over the years, many years, started out to be three, ended up being 6 years of writing, editing, and revising, we came to feel that our three brains kind of combined to be one mind, And there was no way we could have written anything without each other's input and provocations and support. This experience of this kind of deeply connected mode of knowing has shaped almost all of my work since. And I would say that I've also been really affected by having deep, and I could say loving, relationships with such incredibly courageous and creative people. Has really just nourished my life in so many ways. And that fact that many of us continue to do good work together is really important. But here I want to focus on one of the contributions I think acting together did make and could still make for the field that we're now calling arts, culture, and conflict transformation. Acting together was an experiment in understanding how performance contributes to peace building. This meant engaging with questions like these. How can we navigate between the profound, but often subtle and sometimes unknowable effects of artistic production on the one hand, and the important work of documenting and improving peace-building practice, including arts and culture-based efforts, on the other? How can we bring into one view the socio-political cultural context within which we live and work, where peace builders often focus, and the intensity and transformative power of the spaces where creative work occurs, which is often the focus of artists and cultural workers. An idea emerged as we began to think about the 14 case studies that comprise the anthology. It was an idea first articulated by the poet Adrienne Rich. She wrote, "There's a permeable membrane between art and society, a continuous dialectical motion, tides brining the estuary, river flowing into sea. Likewise, the matter of art enters the bloodstream of social energy, call and response." All this is in chapter 6 of the second volume of the anthology, if you want to explore further. So when we try to think about what distinguishes peace-building performance from all performance, we asked ourselves, what in that instance is this permeable membrane actually made of? What is it, if we go deeply into it? We proposed in the book that the membrane between art and society is comprised of the ethical and aesthetic sensibilities of artists, cultural workers, and producers responsible for performance. And in peace-building performance in particular, we test the idea that the permeable membrane is comprised of the moral imagination. So the moral imagination is another idea that really animated the Acting Together project and still does. It refers to the idea articulated by John Paul Lederach about the moral imagination. John Paul Lederach is a peace building scholar and practitioner. He says that the moral imagination is what happens. It's the ability to stay grounded in the suffering and injustice of the real world, and also simultaneously to reach for a better, more just, less violent, more vibrant world. And in ways that you can explore further, he links this moral imagination to disciplines that we can practice in our lives all the time about creativity, risk-taking, interdependence, and paradoxical curiosity. So this framework of the permeable membrane between arts and society focuses on, as I said, the ethical and aesthetic commitments of the artists and producers of peace-building performances. This framework invites us to ask, what are the matters from the social political world that get brought into the creative space, in this case of performance? And how do they enter? Through what pathways? Through agendas of NGOs, through artists' imagination, through questions that audience members bring up following a performance? And how are these elements, these stories, feelings, fears, and hopes, for instance, how are they actually transformed in the creative space? I'll just say, for instance, by the expression of that which has been repressed or suppressed, through the affirming and unleashing of capacities, perhaps capacities that might have been eclipsed through trauma and fear, And how does the moral imagination itself in the creative space work on imperatives such as, again, in the case of acting together, resistance, memory, quest for justice, and identity? Mm-hmm. And finally, how are these transformations that happen in the creative space cast back out into the world of everyday life through new ideas, through new language, through new relationships, through new commitments, et cetera? So as I said, this theory of the permeable membrane is laid out in chapter 6 of the second volume of the anthology. So given all the richness of the case studies themselves, it perhaps hasn't received as much attention as it might. I nevertheless think that this framework will continue to strengthen urgent and necessarily collaborations among artists, cultural workers, and peace builders. Let's see what happens. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you both. How do you see the it emerging from the place where it is now? Like, think about it's been 10 years, a remarkable achievement. But looking forward to the next 10 years, what are your hopes?
I'll start, Polly, and then you can. Immediately, one of the things that we're doing is creating a translation through subtitles of the documentary into Ukrainian, and hope to use that in refugee communities with Ukrainian people to invite artists to, you know, think about their contributions. And we may also create a version in Russian and then be able to do some cross-community work through screenings of the documentary and conversations that follow. I will just say that one of the great things about acting together, because, and I have to tribute Allison with a lot of this, because of the beauty of the documentary and the power of it, is that it's opened so many doors for us. For instance, just to take one thread, some members of the Office of the High Commissioner on Human Rights saw the documentary at a conference where I wasn't even there, I don't think. I don't know if any of us were there. But on that basis, they invited us to contribute to a report of the Special Rapporteur on Cultural Rights about culture and reconciliation. And that's led also to relationships with UNESCO and some work that Polly and Tony Shapiro-Pym, my colleague at Brandeis, who's also here today, are doing now in establishing ethical criteria for work in communities facing different kinds of precarities. So there's so much that's happening actually that builds on acting together. Now, I'll turn it over.
And Polly?
Muted.
I think you're on mute.
Thanks.
Yeah, you're still muted.
Yeah. Building on what Cindy has said, I would love for us to be able to engage in all the different curators addressing what's changed in the last 10 years. I know, for instance, in that chapter that I wrote about reconciliation rituals between Indigenous and settler peoples, both here in Turtle Island and in Australia, there have been significant changes. And yet powerful work continues to be done through performance and through the arts to engage with issues of coloniality. And I'm concerned sometimes when you do a book, it's a written and a static document. And people could read something and say, well, that's not what I'm seeing in lived experience. Discount all the impressive and powerful work that's being done. So I would love to see us find a way to update what's happening in these different locations around the world and how the arts are being used currently to address injustice and to transform conflict.
Wow, wonderful. Is there going to be a volume 3 come out? Okay. This is, thank you both. And please, if you're listening and you're in this room, please ask questions and make comments in the chat and we'll be able to continue the discussion. But I'd like to bring more people into the conversation. Allison, you have created an extraordinary film. And I, as I said, I've seen it several times. Would you talk us a little bit about the creation and what you see has changed in the 10 years since?
Sure. Hello, everyone. I want to give hugs to all of the Acting Together and Theater Without Borders artists who were able to make it today. You all have been living with me in my studio for 10 years. So it's been grand, really. When we first started, an original idea was for me to consider the context of 10 years with this film. And as the filmmaker, of course, I just so easily went to, you know, we're thinking about longevity and then datedness. So to think about the film, I start thinking about the low resolution of cameras from 10 years ago. And I think about the very slow pacing of the film, which you all are so nice. And I agree, like, stick with it. It's 50 minutes and it is so rewarding at the end. But, you know, really, you could probably watch like 17 TikToks within one fade to black. So those are the things that my mind often thinks about. But when I just turned to the documentation piece of it, the comments of these artists, the pieces of theater that you are able to see, then all I think is about the vibrancy and livingness and relevance of this work. And I'm going to give one example of that. I mean, I really could go on and on, but I'm thinking of this video from 10 years ago, and I watched a podcast and made a connection. And a podcast is a recent medium that really didn't exist when we started this project. But the podcast was on gaming, and it took up the book Seeing Like a State, James C. Scott. And one of his ideas was that a state or a big entity sees best through mathematical analysis, equations, measures, and turns things into digestible pieces of information. And so this type of data is easy communication, not always good communication, because number systems don't take up the deep qualitative expression of human interaction. There is often, or I don't know, always, so little nuance in numbers. And then that led them to start talking about what are the current number systems that we use. And I think if you can all do it with me, hits, clicks, follows, retweets, likes. And again, these numbers are really good at narrow information capture, at flattening reactions into thin pieces of information. That again are, it's easy communication. And then it was so interesting to start describing the kind of yin to that yang of shrinking communication. They started using theater terminology. So in the performance and ritual space, artists dwell in the magnitude of the current. Artists reflect back to the audience who they are. Peacebuilding performance tries to address the community, their community, with depth, with complexity, keeping the complexity there. So performance interacts in the realm of the boundless and the immeasurable. In the documentary, Marianne Hunter talks about the big messiness of humanity and that theater is messy. So we have seeing like a state. Well, seeing like a performance is looking deeply, being present, not turning away from the immeasurable, unbearable. It is to be responsible, to make complex creative response. T.S. Eliot says, quote, "We rarely penetrate to the substratum of our being, for our lives are mostly a constant evasion of ourselves." Roberta Levito says, "All of these theater artists refuse to be in denial." Like, and I say that all the time to myself, refuse, and I hear her voice, refuse to be in denial. So I'm going to end with a quote from one of the hundreds of events that this group of artists has been involved with in different ways. It was at the Odyssey Theater in LA. And one of the participants said, "The work you're doing is so impressive. And the idea of bringing all these far-flung artists into conversation, thereby creating a movement, is truly inspired." So to Cindy, the originator, and to all of Theater Without Borders, and to the University of Iowa with this fabulous, the archives and the certificate program. And then to everyone here, because you've brought yourself into this complex conversation, you are truly inspired.
Thank you. Thank you, Allison. Great. Well, I'd like to introduce now some artists who have joined us, who've been involved with Theater Without Borders and the Acting Together project and refuse to be in denial. First, Shahid Nadeem, core member of Theater Without Borders, founder of the Ajoka Theatre in Pakistan. Shahid is Pakistan's leading playwright, and his plays are well regarded for their bold, socially relevant, sometimes tabooed subjects such as religious extremism, violence against women, discrimination against minorities, freedom of expression, climate, peace, and Sufism. Several of his plays address the issues of partition of South Asia and shared cultural heritage of the region. He skillfully combines contemporary social and political themes with traditional forms and folk heritage to present an entertaining and intellectually stimulating theater. In his World Theater Day message, he was the international presenter of the message of World Theater Day. He said, "We need to replenish our spiritual strength. We need to fight apathy, lethargy, pessimism, greed, and disregard for the world we live in, the planet we live on. Theater has a role, a noble role, in energizing and mobilizing humanity to lift itself up from its descent into the abyss. It can uplift the stage, the performance space, into something sacred." Shahid, we're so pleased that you could join us. Are you in Lahore now?
Yeah, well, I hope you can hear me. It's a pleasure to be among people who have made such valuable contribution to the cause of Theater Without Borders and bringing theater activists from different cultures, different backgrounds. So I'm honored.
Would you please tell us a little bit about your experience with Theater Without Borders and the work you're doing?
Well, borders are a big problem for people like me living in Pakistan, where we keep on creating borders, physical borders. Like in 1947, we created border between India and Pakistan. In 1971, we created borders between East Pakistan and West Pakistan. East Pakistan became Bangladesh. And similarly, crossing borders, especially crossing over to the Western countries, is a huge challenge for all of us, including theater activists. So for me, coming into contact with Theater Without Borders and Roberta was an amazing experience. When I joined one of the conferences held at La Mama in New York and met people from La Mama and Theater Without Borders and other theater practitioners from different countries, I think that was, we had been in contact with our counterparts in India or Bangladesh, but this was our first international contact with the theater groups from America, from Europe, from Africa. And I think we, in that conference, if I recall, which was the beginning, I think acting together was actually in the process of production at that time. And it was really opening up of a new world, new friends, and new experiences, which somehow felt like our own experiences. So I saw some extracts from the acting together at that time. And I remember how I felt close to the groups in, say, Latin America, Philippines, or Serbia, Africa, how I could relate to their experience. And then that connection has been there ever since. And I have been at Brandeis, and I have been in contact with Cindy and with Roberta and with Diamond. And I think that in very, very difficult times, when there is hardly any where you can share your experiences, or you can get inspiration from your colleagues, Theatre Without Borders provide that opportunity. And especially during the times of pandemic, when we were all so desperate, we were not able to contact the theatre group in the next town, but we were still able to have connection with Theatre Without Borders or with other groups available all over the world to inspire you and to share your experiences. So I think that I have been privileged to be in contact with Theatre Without Borders. And we have our own Theatre Without Borders, that is Pakistan and India, where we are in denial of the borders created 75 years ago. That is between present-day Pakistan and India. And our work in the past 38 years, that is Ajoka's age, my theater group, and I'm a bit older than that. So we have established, we have kind of crossed these borders when they were uncrossable. I mean, there were so many restrictions that you could not even talk to your friends on the other side of the border on telephone or letters, or even exchange of books, leave alone sharing your productions. But we managed that. And in some cases, we had to travel from Pakistan to Dubai, from Dubai to India, because there were no flights between India and Pakistan. And the on-ground crossing of border was not allowed. So we had to go all the way from Dubai to Delhi and Delhi to Amritsar or Chandigarh, just to be able to meet our theater friends and later on share our performances. So that little Theater Without Borders is also prospering. And especially this year, which is the 75th anniversary of partition, we have been lately, fortunately, some connections have been restored, and we have been able to meet each other. And we are now planning a festival next month, in which we are expecting some friends from India, especially the Indian side of Punjab, which is shared between Pakistan and India. Part of Punjab is in Pakistan and part in India. So this struggle and this determination to carry on the message of hope and peace building, and sharing our theatrical performances, and our sharing not only with theater practitioners, but with the audience. And I may end with just mentioning that even in the most difficult and most tense times, when the governments were not talking to the governments, people were not talking to the people, journalists were shouting at each other, we, in even those difficult times, we have been able to carry on with our performances. And people, they said that even if they have political differences, when they enter the theater hall, all the differences, all the prejudices are left out. And when they enter the hall, they enjoy not only the production, but the theme and common cultural heritage. So I think theater, like you have presented in Acting Together or activities of Theater Without Border, I think theater is still, it gives hope to the humanity for sharing their experiences and sharing their hopes for future.
Thank you. That's so inspiring. I think, you know, I think that's absolutely right. And I think it's something that we continually learn over and over again. When people come together and they have a shared experience, a shared cultural experience, then a lot of the divisions just go away. So thank you for all the work that you've been doing. It's extraordinary. Now I'd like to introduce Dijana Milosevic, who is a core member of Theater Without Borders and artistic director and founder of DA Theater in Belgrade, Serbia. Da's over 25 years old. Is it now? Is it 27 or
31, believe it or
31,
not.
31. They had published a source book on their anniversary with essays from people around the world who have been touched by the work. Da was founded at a very tense and difficult time, and they proceeded to do their performances in the street, in public, despite the violence that was going on around them. Dijana and her company have traveled all over the world. I've had the pleasure of seeing them in several places, including in Belgrade, where I was fortunate to gain a Fulbright grant to come and spend time with them. And also at La MaMa Umbria International, where we run our programs for directors and playwrights. Dijana had been leading some workshops there and shared her, not only her beautiful presence and style, but her methodology of how she works with performers to create these really impactful productions. Welcome, Dijana. Would you please tell us a little bit about your experience with Theater Without Borders, and then if you'll introduce us to your new project, Impact.
Thank you so much, David. It's really a big, first of all, pleasure and then an honor to be in the presence of all of you here, and also very dear friends that we became through all these years of actually working together on the world stage. And when I was looking this short trailer of the movie, I was again surprised how moved I was. And I saw the full documentary, of course, numerous times at different events. I was presenting it at conferences and so on. So I think I know it almost as Allison by heart. And still, I'm every time I see it, I'm deeply moved and touched. So Allison, thank you once again for this incredible piece of the film, because there are not so many films that could really leave this kind of impact. So I really, really recommend to everyone to see it, if not. So David, thank you for all these great words you said. We do exist for 31 years, believe it or not. And I'm always saying that I believe in longevity, that this is something at the top of my values, like longevity of relationships, of organizations, of simply of visions people are doing. And so I think this is how we actually managed to exist for 31 years with the vision that somehow sustained us from the beginning to here. Cindy, Polly, and maybe some others heard this. I repeated it several times, that actually when I was invited, I believe it was 2005, for the kind of the first gathering of the what is going to be acting together project or network. For the first time then, I heard that I understood by hearing what they were speaking and what we were all speaking about, that what we were doing at Dach Theater in my country, Serbia, was actually peace building. And it was incredible opening. Somehow it was, of course, Theater Without Borders and acting together on the world stage are initiatives or networks that somehow I encountered together. And I can't say now whom I met first or second, but what from this perspective, I can say that what is amazing is that acting together developed and did so many incredible projects and this film and these two anthologies, and that it is still existing in many different ways and shapes. So I know that we all feel in this moment, in a way, also depressed because we are facing one more very big war, many other wars that we are not actually hearing about, that we started to hear about a little bit more. And we are asking ourselves, what could we do? And is it what we are working on, bringing any kind of change? And I can say absolutely yes, because this is also my experience working with my theater, because how to really something that we learned very soon in our let's say life of Dach, how can we actually confront violence without becoming violent ourselves? And this is through creation, this is through creating the sense, and this is what all we are doing here. And also I can say that what we did at Dach, but also acting together, and then I'll talk a little bit about impact, is really bringing people's stories in the light and making them acknowledged. And many times I heard from the people who were touched by those stories, or sometimes or histories, or sometimes they were those were their stories, that they were so grateful that their stories were publicly acknowledged. And of course, very often the work we were doing and we are doing served for facing the past, dealing with denial. And again, it's really something very important what Roberta said. It's inspiring people to refuse denial and to be in basically ignorance about the world. Acting together initiated in a way or placed seed for impact. And of course, Cindy and Polly and Lee Perman initiated impact as a platform, but then many others joined. And I'm one of the people that had that privilege to join. And for those who don't know, impact is was basically devised as the platform for arts, culture, and conflict transformation, with a mission: diverse, dynamic, and imaginative impact works globally to illuminate and strengthen the field of arts, culture, and conflict information transformation. Until now, impact exists for, I believe, about 6 years, and it is, or Cynthia, you can correct me, but it is something that is evolving constantly. Right now, we pass the restructuring process, and we are trying from being kind of the loose network that is working in the field of arts, culture, and conflict transformation to become more structured entity that could really serve to the field, and which aim is really to do the capacity building and advocacy and connectivity between this ecosystem, as we like to call it. So impact is something I can say that was triggered from acting together, and this is really incredible how initiatives and ideas evolve, and this really gives hope.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll look forward to seeing the impact of impact as you move it forward.
Thank you.
Exciting. Thank you. Thank you so much. I wanted to turn our attention now to project with Iowa, and to welcome Lisa Schlesinger, the core member of Theater Without Borders and the University of Iowa Department of Theater Arts faculty and founding committee member of the new Performing Arts and Social Justice Certificate, along with Jen Shook, visiting professor in theater and performance history at University of Iowa, and Rob Ascher, MFA candidate and the University of Iowa in dramaturgy, who I believe is off camera now and monitoring the chat and working with all the technical aspects. But they are going, I'll let them talk to you about what their current initiatives are. And we welcome you and thank you for hosting us today. Hey, Lisa.
Hi, everyone. It's so great to see you all, and thank you for all you've spoken on already. I'm so grateful that you're doing the work you're doing. I'm honored to be in your company today. And on behalf of the University of Iowa, we recently acquired the Archives of Theater Without Borders through Roberta Levito's gracious ideas and gift. And together with Kat Fiu's planning and questioning and inquiry through conversation a couple of years ago, pre-COVID, long before, in the before times. I don't know how it happened, but kind of magically, we all discovered that it would be absolutely beautiful to home the archives at the University of Iowa. And we have, during COVID, Roberta sent the archives to the university and is currently being processed. So it is not yet accessible to the public, but it will be accessible within the next year. And at that time, we'll have a welcoming celebration. Somehow in confluence with this, with acquiring the archive, we had been planning a certificate in performing arts and social justice. And we thought it would take a long, long time, but come to find out, it went quickly. And that certificate will be live and implemented in the fall of 2022.
Wonderful. That's so exciting. And we're so thrilled that at Theater Without Borders that you're able to take on this archive and that's a home now where people can have access to all of the experience and information that's included there.
And with great thanks to Roberta for creating an archive.
Yeah.
And, you know, in a way it's the beginning of an archive because Roberta has so many really interesting texts that are not otherwise accessible, artifacts from the 20 years of Theater Without Borders. But we also are aware that there are core members of Theater Without Borders all around the world who may want to contribute their works and artifacts to that archive so that it will be accessible.
Great, yeah, let everybody know maybe in the chat how people can access, well, I know when it's ready they can access it, but also contribute their own materials to the archive. A great treasure trove of documents and information. Jen, would you like to share what's going on for you in this process and how it's been?
Well, I feel very grateful to be at the University of Iowa in this moment that these pieces are coming together. It's so great to hear and to hear and learn from the 10 years and more experience from acting together in Theater Without Borders. And I'm also being mindful of some exciting things that are going on in the chat. So some exciting and also sobering things that are going on in the chat. So as Dijana mentioned, there are multiple wars happening, many that we're not hearing so much about. Louisa is pointing out that we're not hearing so much about Burma. And then we had a comment about censorship affecting artists. So that may be something perhaps that panelists would like to speak to. how they see censorship affecting arts and theater and work in conflict right now. And we also have a question about, Lisa, could you share a little bit more what the social justice certificate will entail at the University of Iowa? I know it's new, but what do we know about that? And I'm just going to throw all the questions out at once. So, David, you can help me wrangle them, but also panelists, tell us what speaks to you. Multiple conflicts, multiple censorships, but also some hopeful movements in terms of this new certificate. What do we know about it? And how can we apply what we have learned from acting together in Theater Without Borders to movements now in theater making now and teaching students and young artists about social justice?
Really, oh, wonderful questions. I think we need another 2 hours, but Lisa, yeah, tell us about the certificate and what it entails.
We'll start small because then I want to bring all the places back and address larger issues. But the social justice certificate, Performing Arts and Social Justice Certificate, was started in the Department of Theater Arts with music, with dance, and with gender, women, sexuality studies departments. So Lois Arthur, I think, started this sort of energy of this certificate through community engagement certificate. And we just felt in this moment that it was the way to move our program in theater arts forward. So everyone got behind it. We would like it to be a practice-based certificate. There will be some theory, but it will be community engagement, performance-oriented, practice-based. So having the archive from Theater Without Borders is very, you know, it's a gift to have that history and to see how practice works in the world.
Great, thank you. And when does it begin, or how's it?
Well, it will lift in the fall of 2022, and just the beginning of creating a curriculum and programming and connecting with the other departments to see which courses will fit into that certificate.
Okay, great. Thanks, Lisa. It's exciting. Let's get to this question of censorship, and this is open to all the panelists, anybody who's here, because the question came up of how censorship affects this kind of work that you're doing, and I would love to hear from whoever would like to comment on that. I can't see everybody's face at the moment. I could change my view. Yeah, Dijana.
Yeah, I was thinking about this question, and we can speak about two kinds of censorship, like, let's say, good old censorship, which means that government or someone forbids someone's work, and which we heard about it, and of course it's terrible, of course it's bad and wrong and all of that. But what bothers me even more today is this invisible censorship that is happening actually through the social media and through the ways of how we communicate. And I think that when, for example, Putin forbade Pussy Riot, that was of course terrible, but it was very visible. It was in a way very clear. And of course, the consequences for these artists were very difficult and harsh, but at least the, let's say, enemy was very clear and they knew how to confront it. But today, when we are having the facts about the war in Ukraine in Facebook, let's say, together with food for dogs, together with someone's party, and so on and so on, and all of this we see in, let's say, 10 or 20 seconds, I think that this is the very special, subtle way of censorship when the real information situation or emotion or relationship is completely basically obstructed, and we can't take everything so fastly anymore that is put on the level of the same importance. So this is what I think today, that we need to be extremely clever how to read between lines and how to really take what is important as really important.
Yeah, thank you for that. Shahid.
Yeah, I agree with Diana, especially about the new forms of censorship in view of the social media. The governments in Pakistan are also frantically trying to control the freedom which is now being enjoyed by many social media platforms. And only yesterday, a very draconian law passed by the government was thrown out by the High Court. And that was a big victory for sources, for the forces of freedom of expression. But I would also like to mention that there is another form of censorship, apart from the obvious censorship and visible or invisible censorship. One is the self-censorship or the internalized form of censorship. So this happens when you are aware of not only the government response to whatever you want to express and the response of the powerful people in society, but also the common people. So issues like blasphemy or issues like national security, their stage comes when the artist or the writer, him or herself, wants to regulate and prevent himself from expressing things which he would have otherwise expressed. And I think there, in my view and my experience, they actually, for artists, performing artists and theater people, there are always ways of bypassing censorship. Sometimes we think that, okay, certain laws have been issued, certain restrictions have been imposed, and it means you can't touch this particular subject. But in my experience, I have touched the most controversial, most tabooed, most sensitive subjects in most terrible conditions, but with a little bit of creativity, a little bit of humor, a little bit of music, a little bit of high drama, and a little bit of decoy. Sometimes people who you are targeting, they are sitting in the front row and are amused, but rest of the public gets the message. So I think we should always be aware that censorship is going to be there in one form or the other, hard or soft. But there are always ways of bypassing or dodging the censors. That is the beauty of drama or poetry.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. Cindy. I think you're on mute. Yeah.
Got it. I have two ideas, actually. One is that in the Acting Together anthology and film and toolkit also, which we haven't really mentioned here yet, mm-hmm. there's many examples of how the resources of performance allowed people to circumvent or overcome the censors. Like, for instance, Palestinian people putting their main message in the lyrics of song because the Israeli military censors never really looked at the lyrics of songs. I think similar to what you were suggesting, Shahid, Charles Mulekwa talking about, you know, the ways that symbols are used that most people understand, but it's not said directly. It seems like there, even more today, we're going to be called on for more creativity in addressing the different kinds of censorship that are in our communities and in our governments. I wanted to bring up like a related issue, I think, which is about the quality of attention, of our attention, and how what we pay attention to is being coerced and manipulated, with powerful images and messages through advertisements or different kinds of television or social media. And our actually, like, our paying attention has become commodified so that people are making profit out of the minutes, the seconds and minutes of what we pay attention to. And that's had such a devastating effect in the world, because what people pay attention to often are the most conflictual statements and images. So it seems also like artists, and in particular perhaps theater artists, have a role to play in reconnecting us to the qualities of attention that we need, qualities of presence that we need in the world, and to invite us to stay present to what's necessary. I just am curious if other people have thoughts about that.
Anybody like to share about that? Or other comments about censorship that haven't been brought up? That quality of attention you're talking about, Cindy, it reminds me very much of the earlier work of Robert Wilson, where you have to attend to something that's very slow and very long, but it changes time. It changes what time means to you as you're experiencing the performance. And it doesn't allow for that kind of quick cut like that we're so used to now. 1 second this and 1 second that. It kind of puts you in a different state. It seems like that kind of performance is a way to help people understand about their attention and time and gives them the space.
Yeah. You're saying that just makes me think of this word metacognitive. Like, we need to become aware of what's happening to our attention, because it's so easy to be seduced into these things that are in some way pleasurable and safe, maybe, I don't know.
We had other questions about, Jen, help me out. There's, I wrote things down very quickly.
I think just this would be a great moment just to ask if there are any final, I love this idea of attention, quality of attention, and I'm grateful for all of your attention and gifts and everyone else's attention throughout this process. So maybe this is a great moment just to say, does anyone have any lingering lessons from your time with, or thoughts from your time with, acting together in Theater Without Borders that you would like to share forward to folks embarking upon and continuing upon such work now? Or any other ways you were thinking about how we can attend to one another in times of conflict?
Yeah, Diana.
Yeah, I can say that this special action that we started to practice in Acting Together and Theater Without Borders, and then especially at Impact, is really thinking together. And this is something that I think is extremely important in today's world, when one's idea is so important. It's so important to say, oh, this is my idea, while we practice really forgetting about whose idea was something or is something, and really thinking together. So I think we need to think together. We are simply better. We are simply smarter. We are simply more imaginative and transformational when we think together. And this could really bring the change. I deeply believe in that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thanks. Polly, you like to say?
I'd like to link back to a question I heard raised for early on, and it was, how do we apply our learnings in these contemporary situations? And Building on what Cindy and Dijana both said, I would encourage everyone to have a look at the toolkit that goes along with the documentary, because we did a lot of thinking together to put that toolkit. And I think it has some very valuable and very relevant documents in it. For example, how to plan and document peacebuilding performance, how to better understand the moral imagination and how that can be integrated into peacebuilding performances, and also minimizing the risks of harm. I think it's, you know, some people say we do know harm, but quite often we do harm we're not aware of. So how do we deepen our understanding of that and improve and enhance the ethics and quality of our work?
Holly, how would people access the toolkit?
You can access that through the website, but did they have to, is there a fee for that, Cindy and Allison?
No, it's on the website under training. There's access. And I love that. I will underscore that too, because in the toolkit, one of the worksheets there is called assessment and evaluation. And so in this way that you, we all have to hold complexity. I think I talked a lot about this sort of immeasurable, but a piece of acting together is really to think very deeply about how do we assess ourselves? And I think those tools are invaluable.
And there are also like many short videos in the toolkit.
Oh, right.
Woven
right.
into trainings. That's really nice.
Yeah. And there's Jen put the link to the toolkit in the chat.
Fab.
And some other comments that. Question came up for Polly about expounding on the delineation of colonists as opposed to settled peoples and its impact on Indigenous and Black and Brown ritual being co-opted in the United States. Like a big issue, but can you share a bit about that?
Yes, and that's a part of the work that we've been doing that Cindy mentioned on articulating ethical principles and practices. And the work, the people that I work with or the people that I choose to affiliate with are ones who work collaboratively building relationship with Indigenous peoples and planning these events collaboratively. If it doesn't arise out of place and a deep relationship with place, if it doesn't arise out of these long sustained relationships, then it's quite easy for Indigenous rituals and ceremonies to be co-opted. And, you know, I think we see, you know, a growing awareness of how, you know, that just continues the ravages of coloniality. So I think, you know, again, honoring place and building those long sustained and authentic relationships. And it's that, I remember who talked about the, I think Allison talked about the messiness of it, this, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years of colonization are messy and painful. And it takes a deep commitment to stay with that and work your way through that.
I encourage everybody to check out the chat. There are many, that just reminds me that there are many different vocabularies at work in the chat and in these conversations, and the richness of the collaborations that you all have been describing in this collaboration of a conversation is attending to the ways that sometimes our vocabularies overlap and sometimes they do not. Well, we are trying to talk both globally and locally specifically at the same time. So again, I just want to echo to encourage everyone to check out the toolkit and resources and documentary and anthologies. And those, in case you did not see in the chat, that full documentary will be available on the link that we posted, which is, I'll read it out loud just in case anybody's having trouble seeing the chats. If I can find it in my notes, it's www.atwresources.com/borderless. You can view the full documentary there for free until May 9th. And before and after that, you can also purchase it at the Acting Together website, which is the beginning part of that website. And then also want to remind you that you can check out theater.uiowa.edu/production/borderless for more upcoming events. And the, oh, thank you, Rob just put all that info in the chat again. And the anthologies are also available for purchase at Prairie Lights Bookstore in Iowa City, as well as on the Acting Together websites. And I think that means I'm moving toward closing us out, because we're
Let me just add, Jen, yes, David, thank you. Please. Let me add that the Theater Without Borders website has lots of resources, and I encourage you to go to that site. It's been recently revamped, and it's an excellent source. We didn't talk too much about it, but this collaboration between Theater Without Borders and the Acting Together project has enriched both so much, and I think it was a brilliant idea and a brilliant execution to put the two organizations together in this kind of a collaboration. So check out all of these sites and Theater Without Borders as well, and I encourage you to check out the LaMama website as well, about a lot of international work being done, bringing people together. But mostly, I think at this point, I really want to say thank you to everybody who's here, everybody who's not here, who has contributed so incredibly to make this project happen and to continue it and to deepen it as it goes along, the learning and the thinking and the depth of the conversation, the learning is extraordinary. And it's a lot of people. And I think Cindy and Roberta and the rest could name, probably list them all, but I think that would take us another half hour. So I just appreciate you all being here and taking part in this conversation. I want to wish Ramadan Mubarak, happy Passover and happy Easter to people that celebrate those things. And to everybody, a peaceful and a energized time moving forward with this work. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye.